Well, it's Valentine's Day coming up. And as fascinating as that is for those in love, it's also a reminder of those we can't stand, we're once in love with, and now no more. Actually, the opposite. There's a Rhode Island lawyer. I've played this before, but it's just so fantastic. There's a Rhode Island lawyer that actually will help you out with your divorce in a very different way.
Hi, I'm Steve Miller. I've been a trial lawyer in Florida and Massachusetts since 1985. If you and your spouse hate each other like poison and want to get out of the hellhole you call a marriage, you've come to the right place. Look, you can waste your money screwing around with some paper pusher paralegal type, give thousands of dollars to some piece of crap three-piece suit downtown, blow your brains out trying to figure out why you wasted 25 bucks on the crappy forms you bought from the illiterate boob at the courthouse, or do what I say and do it now. We know what we're doing here. Look at this website, a work of art. Here's the story. Pay us a little and we get you a lot. Don't worry about the details. We'll take care of business and let you know when to crack open the champagne. Okay, time to move on. Go to the Get the Divorce page in the upper right corner, pay up, and you're on your way to getting rid of that vermin you call a spouse. We're here to help. Divorce EZ, a Florida law firm.
On the air everywhere, this is New England Broadcasting.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. It's the Ron Van Dam Show.
Thank you. Thank
Hold you. On tight, things can get a bit weird, if you like that sort of thing.
Hey, welcome to the program. Always a pleasure to have you here. Not really, I'm just saying that. Hey, Jason Shaw composes the music for the program. That's the music you hear in the background, our opening theme. John Shanahan does our crazy announcements and crazy commercial and comedy stuff. Great, great man. Nicole Reed books a lot of our national interviews that we do on this show, and she's the voice of the British babe that you hear in the beginning, and those are just some of the participants in our little theater group. Make yourself comfortable. This will take a little while. Not that long, though, I swear. Not so bad. It's not so bad. Look, you clicked on this. Don't blame me. For those of you joining us for the very first time, I'm Dr. Phil. The man is starting to grate on my nerves. Phil was a guest on this program years ago, and I thought he was wonderful. Now, not so much. That'll do it. Thank you very much. That's enough. We have a wonderful show today, I believe, in my heart. Yeah, we do. Just wait. It'll happen soon. Just I want you to relax. Close your eyes. Picture yourself in a beautiful setting. You're sitting on a park bench, and there's a beautiful stream in the background, a babbling brook, and it's just wonderful. There's little fish jumping around and little tadpoles and children playing. Not too loud, not too loud, you know, at a decent audio level. And life is beautiful. There are kites flying around and a blue sky and a gentle breeze. Things are just great. And then I come along. That's what the show is. I rattle things. Yes, I do. I'm the grumpy guy who lives next door who won't let your kids on the lawn. Hey, kids, get off my lawn. I spend a lot of money on this thing. Get off my lawn before I smack you. Go away. Stay away from me. Don't come so close to me. I do have an aura. I've been told my aura is orange colored. I don't know what that means. I think Trump's aura is orange colored, whatever. But I have a boundary around me, and don't get too close into that boundary unless I invite you in. I'm like an apartment building where you have to buzz to come upstairs on the intercom. That's me. You want to come close to me? You want to come into my barrier area? You have to ring the buzzer and I have to buzz you in. Otherwise, you're not allowed. Stay off my lawn, kids. I've told you 1,000 times. You do it one more time and I bring out the artillery. You know what I'm saying? Get off my lawn. You kids, you 3-year-old kids got no respect. All you do is yell and scream and run around like you own the world. Well, you don't. I do. Not you. I've been around for many years. You're 3 years old. What do you know? Get off my lawn. Unless you want to mow it. You want to mow my lawn? Happy to do it. All right. Man, I got allergies today. They're driving me nuts. My nose is running all over the place. It's awful. What's with the nose thing? This thing's like in the middle of your face, and all it does is just... it produces snot and phlegm, and it runs liquid. It's just like, what is this thing doing in the center of my face? If you're going to, like, create me with a water faucet of nasal crap, couldn't you put my nose on my ass or something where my pants cover it? In the middle of my face? What a horrible place for that feature. Even the ears, you decide, I'll put them off to the side. Give them two for balance, but put them off to the side, you know? That way, you know, you can cover it with hair if you want to, whatever. But the nose, man, they planted it dead center. What the hell was that about? What the hell was that about? They didn't do it to fish. But they did it to humans. They did it. It was them. They did that. Valentine's Day is coming up, and... Here's a very funny Valentine's gift, which I don't understand at all, because it's not a Valentine's gift, but it's being marketed as a Valentine's gift. If you were once married and you hated your spouse, similar to the first commercial that we played when the show began, if you feel that your ex is a butthead, there is a way you can psychologically get back at them through yourself. And here's what you do. I believe the Bronx Zoo and the El Paso Zoo are doing this, as well as others. You make a donation to the zoo, but you do it in order to get something off your back to make you feel good. Not that, like, helping the animals is enough for you to feel good. You need something else. Well, what do we mostly associate with people that we don't like that have ruined our lives? Cockroaches. Seriously. What's more annoying than a cockroach? Or frightening? These little buggers, apparently... As they say, if there was some type of a nuclear disaster holocaust, the cockroaches would still be walking around. I don't quite believe that, but that's what they say. So we refer to people that we can't stand as cockroaches. So apparently what you do is you name a cockroach. It's like naming a star or a planet or something. You name a cockroach after your ex. I'm going to name that cockroach Sally. And what they do is they take a cockroach, which you now have named Sally, and in your name, with your donation, they feed it to one of the zoo animals. What could be more loving on Valentine's Day? That's a real thing, man. That's a thing. It actually is occurring. I find that fascinating because it's so stupid. I can't believe it. It's just so... awkwardly ridiculous, but fascinating nonetheless. I don't know, man. Hey, look, I just walked the planet. I was plopped here in some maternity ward somewhere, and I developed accordingly. I'm not responsible for any of this stuff. So that's something I would do. Sure, there are people I dislike. Sure, there are people that I would want to feed to hungry zoo animals. Sure, I would want to name them after cockroaches. But at the same time, I wouldn't really feel good about myself. But that's the idea. You're supposed to feel good about doing that. I don't know. Let's stop talking about that because this is going nowhere. We have an extended interview today on this particular program. We do interviews on just about every show that we do here, every episode. Today is a fascinating one. We're going to speak to a couple, a husband and a wife, I believe they are. I haven't spoken to them yet. And they lived with wolves, and not in a zoo pen or anything like that. They went to some place where the wolves run free and wild, and they actually lived with them. They actually raised wolf babies with them, but they didn't. I mean, this was out. They lived in the wild, like for, I think, 3 years, 6 years, something like that. We'll find out. But this couple is just knows wolves inside and out because they were like wolves themselves, living with this wolf pack. Yeah. So we're going to speak to them. Fascinating people. Would I do this? No. Would I live with wolves? No. I can hardly live with people. As a matter of fact, it's quite difficult for me to do so. So living with wolves might be preferable. I have no idea. Anyway, that's coming up on today's show. How you doing? Valentine's Day is coming up soon. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to speak to the men for just a second. The ladies can leave the room. I'm only saying that just as a joke. Stay here. Children should leave the room. Children shouldn't even be in the room for any of my programs. I'm just saying. Unless they're so young, they don't know what the hell I'm talking about. All right. I'll address the young kids for just a second. Ready? Here we go. Baby shark, doot, 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 baby shark. Okay, that's it. Now they're happy. Now they're playing. What is it with this baby shark thing? I'd like to find a person that wrote that song, name a cockroach after them, and feed them to zoo animals. Kids love the baby shark song, but there's one problem with that song. You can't get it out of your fucking head. It's always there. It's tucked away in the back of my brain. And any time I can call it up, even people with total memory loss can remember that song. That's how annoying it is. And it's not like it's an amazing song with amazing orchestration. It's just, it's a stupid little song, and it's only got a couple of words to it. They change it up. They go, baby shark, doot, 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 doot. And then they go, mommy shark. Ooh, they changed it up. Daddy shark. Oh my God. How much further are we going to get into this family tree of sharks? Grandpa shark. Oh my God, this song is complicated. That's pretty much the whole song. Kids love this thing. I don't understand how it doesn't eventually, as they get older, turn them into like insane murderers because it's just so grating on one's nerves. Now, it's endearing to watch a young child sing along and that their first words growing up are not mommy or daddy, it's baby shark. That's a little odd. Yet, nonetheless, I guess it is some educational tool to some extent. But for an adult, I mean, it could be prisoner of war torture. You're treason against our country. We want to know everything that you've been doing subversively with our enemies. I'm not talking. How about now, baby shark? Do 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 do, baby.
Okay, stop, stop. I'll tell you everything. Stop. Just don't sing that song, please. Don't sing that song and then put me in solitary confinement. I will go insane.
That baby shark song. If you were in solitary confinement in a prison, you literally would not be able to find Jesus. Have you noticed everybody in prison finds Jesus? All of us, they're horrible people, and all of a sudden, by sitting in a cell all by yourself, you say, "Well, I've changed. I found Jesus." How can you find Jesus? You're sitting in a cell. Where did you look? Under the bed? What do you mean you found Jesus? What are you talking about? Good time to find him. You should have found him before you did this horrible crime. Now you find him, your timing's off. You should have found Jesus a long time ago if that would have saved you. And then they get out of prison and they commit crimes again and they say, oh, I thought you found Jesus. I know, I lost him. I left prison, I had him with me, and I lost him. Now I can't find him. I think I have to go back to prison again to find him. I don't understand the whole thing. Makes no sense to me. Really doesn't. You know, I get paid to do this. I know you find that to be amazingly impossible. But I do, and that's because we run some commercials here, because, you know, I can't do this for free. I've got to eat. I've got to eat. So we'll be right back after this.
Hi, this is Bob Robinson from Bob's Handy Around the House. I'm a local handyman. I've been in business for the last 50 years on my own, doing light repair work in our area. Whatever you need done. Carpentry, painting, floors, tiling, yard work. I can do it all for you. I'll come to your home and do the work for a very reasonable fee. Naked. I should probably mention that I will be naked while I do this work. Buck naked, not a stitch on me, waving in the wind, in my birthday suit, showing what God gave me. Naked as a jaybird. I'll be naked the whole time. I show up naked. I do the work naked. You pay me while I'm naked. Bob's Handy Around the House. Bob Robinson. You can look me up on Facebook where I am naked.
You're listening to The Big Show by John Van Dan. I wish I could listen to it too. But sometimes he says bad words.
How are you today?
Hello.
Good, Ron. How are you?
Great, thank you. Jim and
Thanks
Jamie.
For having us.
You're welcome. Jim and Jamie Dutcher are joining us. And we're talking about most people spend their time maybe going out to eat, to a movie, and they go to work, they go home, they go to bed. For a while, that wasn't your life, was it?
No, not really.
we lived in a tent.
You lived in a tent. Now, when did this start? How far back does this go?
In 1991, we started the Wolf Project and camped with a pack of wolves for 6 years. We raised them as pups and bottle-fed them from the moment they opened their eyes, and we studied their social behavior and made documentary films and books, and we actually continue doing the same with a nonprofit organization, Living with Wolves, and we speak all over the nation and write books with National Geographic about wolves. They're very misunderstood.
I would assume you would understand them more than anybody, the both of you, having spent that amount of time. What part of the country did this take place in?
This was in Idaho, in the Rocky Mountains, in the Sawtooth Mountains, actually, of Idaho, which is in central Idaho. So that's where we lived with the wolves in a tented camp in 40 degree below zero temperatures all weather.
Oh my goodness! Now it was the two of you. Was there a camera crew that would visit every once in a while? How did that work?
That was us.
It was you. It's just the two of you, and that was it.
We had, we did have other people that would come up and help us,
right? Every once in a while,
occasionally. But generally, it was Jim was the main cameraman, and I was the sound recorder.
Okay.
Now, our children actually helped the camera assistants and setting up camp, and they would camp with us also.
My goodness. Now, how did this actually evolve? The fact that you were raising wolves, where did they Were there adult wolves that brought their young in, or how did that work as the raising part?
A woman in Montana had gotten hold of a pack of wolves that was being experimented on in Alaska, and they were going to be euthanized. And she had seen a mountain lion film that I had produced and thought if she could help with our wolf project, she would supply us pups. And she let her pack breed, and she gave us pups. And we did this three times until at the end of the sixth or the fifth year, the alpha pair of our pack dug a den, or the female did, and we had pups born to the pack. And which, in a way, was amazing because that hadn't happened in about 70 years in Sawtooth Mountains, and they were the first.
Yeah.
They were ambassadors.
And we had to do this in an enclosure. It was the largest enclosure in the world, and it had to be done this way because at the time, wolves were on the endangered species list. Mm-hmm. If you were lucky enough to actually see a wolf, it would probably stop what it was doing, look at you, and run away. Mm-hmm. And if we had the opportunity to habituate a wild pack of wolves, well, the next time somebody pointed something at them, it might not be a film camera.
Right.
And so all behavior studies done on wolves have been done with captive packs in small enclosures of 1 to 3 acres. So right. We had the largest enclosure in the world.
Well,
so, even though the wolves were comfortable with us, they weren't pets. We couldn't just come to them,
right.
But they could. They would come to us if they chose to.
Okay. Did you face any life-threatening dangers? I assume that a pack of wolves would be facing this on a regular basis when you're out in the wild, as any group of animals may. Were there life-threatening situations?
No, wolves are, they don't attack or kill human beings. That has maybe one or two in 100 years. And, and it's usually when the wolf has been habituated to a garbage dump and it's an unnatural situation.
Okay.
Wolves are very curious. They live in family packs. And the leaders of the packs, the alphas or the breeding pair, are the only two that breed most of the time. If there is a lot of animals to be fed upon, maybe the alphas, the leaders, will allow the beta wolves to breed too.
Okay.
If there's nothing much to be fed upon, if food is scarce, they won't breed at all, and they'll skip that year.
Mm-hmm. What about the dangers to yourselves and the pack of wolves collectively from other animals in the wild?
Well, that actually was an issue. We did have a situation where a mountain lion had gotten into the enclosure and killed one of the wolves.
Oh.
And it was a very traumatic time for us and the wolves because, we didn't know if the cougar was still in the area.
Yeah.
And it, what was really amazing about that was that, the wolves were visibly shaken up. They would generally howl with a lot of exuberance and joy. And after this wolf had been killed, they would go around the area with their heads in a low, listless manner. And if they howled, it was very singularly and very, very, very sad, and it was very obvious to us that the pack was mourning. They truly missed her, and it was a very traumatic time for all of us.
Yeah, one thing wolves do when you watch wolves anywhere, if a half hour goes by and there isn't any playing, that's a very unusual half hour, and so we would observe play all the time.
Mm-hmm.
After this event with the mountain lion killing the omega, the pack didn't play for 6 weeks. So they were were visibly upset losing this pack member.
Mm. What about yourselves? You're humans. And here you are living this way for quite a period of time, becoming incredibly attached to the pack, I would assume, and vice versa. And then there comes a time when that ends. How do the wolves handle that? How do you handle that?
It was difficult. We knew that it was going to happen, that the project was going to have an end. And it was a very difficult emotional time for, I think, for us and for the Wolves. Mm-hmm. We did, because, you know, for your audience, the project was done on Forest Service land, and, you know, our permits could not be, mm-hmm. you know, extended for forever and ever. So we always knew we were going to have to find a permanent home, mm-hmm. which we did in northern Idaho on the Nez Perce tribal lands, the Nez Perce Reservation tribal lands. And we had trained caretakers to go with the Wolves that the Wolves were comfortable with and felt good about. So that's how we made the transition. After the Wolves were moved to live on the Nez Perce land, we did go and visit them on a fairly regular basis, but mm-hmm. I think it just became a little too hard for all of us. They would, you know, they would keep waiting for, like a dog, keep waiting for you to come back, and it just, we eventually kind of ended it after a while, but then the pack members had started passing away, so it was pretty much the end of the project. Yeah. But it was hard. It was heart-wrenching.
What is the lifespan of a wolf?
Oh, well, in Yellowstone, it's about 5 years.
Oh, that's
Being a wolf is pretty difficult. You know, they have to feed on animals that are much, much bigger than them, and they can get killed by a kick to the face and the jaw broken, a broken leg. So about 5 years in captivity, they could live a lot longer.
Yeah, but, in Yellowstone, though, there have been a few wolves that have made it to a ripe old age of I think 8 or 10, but that's very, very rare.
Yeah. Well, as filmmakers, are we able to see the film? I mean, I'm not aware.
Oh, we've got several films. One is Wolves at Our Door, and the other is Living with Wolves.
Okay.
Those, I think those are probably still available online. Those have come out a while. We've been, you know, we've been doing lately is, you know, we started a nonprofit organization, Living with Wolves, dedicated to educational outreach, and we've been writing several books about our experiences with the wolves with National Geographic.
Right.
Yeah, the most recent one just came out this month, and it's for middle school and high school level. It's called Running with Wolves.
Uh-huh.
But you can find all our books on our website, livingwithwolves.org.
Okay. What's next for the both of you?
Oh, more of the same. We, you know, after spending so much time living with and filming the wolves, we were, you know, had been asked, you know, can you go, you know, film something else or move on to something else? And we thought about it, and wolves still need so much help. They're so misunderstood that, like I said, we started this nonprofit organization, Living with Wolves, and that's what we do. We speak all over the country, all over the world. Good. We have photography exhibits, just trying to dispel the myths about wolves and get people to understand this important social keystone species that we have here in America. You know, we understand how important elephants, whales, dolphins, you know, gorillas are, and we're so lucky to have wolves, which really keep our ecosystems intact and make everything better, and they're so social and so compassionate and really live their lives a lot like us. You can see how early humans and wolves came together to eventually domesticate the dog. And so that's what we do, more speaking, more educating.
Yeah. Well, it's important.
We work with an organization down in Colorado, the Rocky Mountain Wolf Project, and we have an exhibit in Boulder right now that's been traveling the state.
Right.
There's another exhibit at the Detroit Zoo. We do a lot of work with National Geographic.
Wonderful. Well, it's a perfect match for you, that's for sure. No question about that. Well, I mean, it's important that humans understand that they're not the only entities that were placed on this globe. So that's great that people understand that. I'm still trying to understand how you live with humans. I don't think it's possible, but
it's much easier to live with wolves.
I would assume. I don't even question that. Okay. One more time where we can go for more information.
For more information, you can visit our website at livingwithwolves.org. Living with Wolves is also on Facebook. And, you know, we encourage people to come and visit the website, learn more about what we do and more about wolves. We also have an interactive exhibit on our website. And, you know, there you can find information about our books and films.
Beautiful. What a wonderful way to spend your life. And thank you for doing that, by the way, so that you can be a window for us.
Well, thanks, Ron.
Yeah, thanks for helping us.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye.
Bye.
Wow, fascinating stuff, man. You're better people than I am, I'll tell you that right now. I admit it. I'm raising my hand. You're better than I am. And that takes a lot for me to admit. It really does. Stay off my lawn. That's all I'm asking. I don't ask a lot. Hey, have yourselves a wonderful day. Next time a weekday rolls around, we'll be back with a brand new episode. Until then, I wish you peace.